Well, hello, and thank you for joining us for our weekend editions of Bible study. We're going to look into lives of great Christians like we promised last week. And we're with D.L. Moody, Dwight L. Moody. This is the second in a series of, I believe, 25. And this one's called Layman from God. So here we go. Take a listen and leave a comment.
Stories of great Christians.
For most of it, you'll probably be seeing me. I don't want to hold this for 15 minutes in the same place.
We are bringing you from the radio studios of the Moody Bible Institute in Chicago, Chapter 2 in the story, Layman from God, a portrait of D.L. Moody. That's the Boston in Maine, passing Northfield, Massachusetts, on the Connecticut River route. Young Master Moody would follow its wondrous call of far-off places, new adventure and excitement, until it was out of earshot. Later in the day, he would bend his ears for the Vermont in Massachusetts, as it hissed, snorted, and puffed its way northward. The mournful wail haunted him day and night, and his feet itched to get going. Oh, how he wanted to break away and find the world on his own. He knew that he could be successful out there. He knew he was ready. Oh, how positive D.L. was about that. His 17 years of self-esteem and confidence filled him to the brim. But the question is, was he ready? To find out, let's go back a few years and look at young Mr. Moody's life.
Right? Let me look at you.
Yes, Ma.
Hands?
Here they are. See, I washed them both.
Turn them over.
Oh, Mama.
You didn't wash the back of your hands, did you?
No, Mama, but I don't use the back of my hands. Just the front.
Whatever am I going to do with you? Now go and walk.
Mama, the stage is coming down the road. I don't have time.
Oh, all right. Now, have you got your fare?
I got a nickel.
Dwight, the fare is 10 cents to Grandmother Holton's.
Hey, please, I want a ride.
Whoa, hold up there.
Want a
ride, son?
Sure do. Over to my grandma's house. It's 4 miles, and I've got a nickel.
Hey, the fare's 10 cents, son, and I got a full stage.
Can I ride up there with the trunks and stuff for a nickel? Please, mister. If you charge 10 cents for the set, a nickel ought to do for riding on top.
Well, all right, young feller. Come on, climb up here and sit there with the baggage.
Thanks, mister.
Come on, hang on. Get up there. Come on, get up.
Lance takes that boy as a caution. I don't know why I worry about him when he does pretty well for himself. I wonder how he's going to get home. It's a long walk.
Whoa! Hey, whoa there!
It's me again, mister.
I can see. I sure can see. Hey, the fare's 10 cents, son.
I ain't got 10 cents, and I ain't got a nickel, but I got these. I picked them just for you.
Hey, a bouquet of wildflowers. Another one of caraway.
Your wife will like the flowers. She can use the caraway seed of bread. Please, mister, I gotta get home before dark.
Yeah, come on. Get up there with the rest of the bag. Come on.
Thanks, mister.
Come on, get up there. We gotta make up time.
Bringing my
with these, ma'am.
Flowers and caraway seeds?
It's all right, lady. We made a deal. That's it.
Yeah, us Yankees make good gardeners.
Mother?
In here, George.
Come on, Dwight.
Just because you're older than me, does that make you boss?
That ain't it, Dwight, and you know it. Mother says a promise is a promise.
Let this soft mineral melt in your mouth to rebuild your gums and teeth and never need a dentist again. Did you know there is a...
What's the problem between you two?
Mother, Dwight's trying to get me to get him out of his promise to Mr. Green about working for his board.
Is that correct, young man?
Yes, sir. But all he ever feeds the guy is cornmeal and milk. 19 meals straight. That's what he fed me. Cornmeal and milk.
Ain't no better food than that, Mother.
That's true, George. What do you have to say, Dwight?
But, Mother, I can't. I just can't.
That isn't the question, son. Did you promise? Come on. Did you or did you not promise Mr. Green to work for your boy?
I did promise, Mother.
Well, then.
I'll go back and keep my promise. Promise is a promise. Don't make it unless you can keep it.
Resourcefulness, integrity, high moral values, keen wits, and sharp mind. These were assets to young Master Moody. Liabilities? Ah, yes. He had his faults just like any other human being. His major fault, especially in his youth, was that of the incurable prankster. Even his mother's exasperated use of a stout green switch across his backside couldn't cure his love for the practical joke. The closing exercises in the local school was a big event, and young Master Moody just couldn't let this go by without pulling off one of his most outlandish practical jokes. D.L. and his classmates were giving the moving scene from Shakespeare's Julius Caesar, where Mark Antony made his oration over the body of the dead ruler. Everything was set for the scene. A box resting on the teacher's desk was Caesar's coffin. The room crowded with parents and friends of the students. Guess who played the part of Mark Antony? That's right. None other than the prankster himself rose up to start the famous speech. Master Moody struggled along with solemn gestures as he portrayed the part, which ends with these lines.
I am no orator, as Brutus is, but as you know me all, a plain, blunt man that love my friends, and they that know full well that give me publicly to speak
the pitch. The Yankee Mark Antony continued his discourse, drawing close to the dramatic end. His attention was riveted on the lid of the box representing the dead ruler's coffin. His hands came closer and closer to the lid as he rose to the occasion of ending this dramatic scene.
Would ruffle up your spirits and put a tongue at every wound of Caesar. They should move the stones of Rome to rise in mutiny.
Perhaps the stones of Rome didn't mutiny, but the folks in the schoolhouse sure did, as the frightened tomcat made his break for freedom. I think it would be safe to say that Master Moody stood the better part of several days, because it hurt too much to sit down.
Yes, yes. No man should play a joke unless he's willing to take one.
Yes, in all fairness, we have to say that D.L. could take a joke and laugh at himself just as heartily as when the fun was on someone else. In later years, as his judgment matured, he wasn't so violent or bold with his tricks and pranks. Children and young people everywhere loved him for his ability to enter into the spirit of the occasion wholeheartedly. The young man, the dreamer, took a while to gather up his courage and make the final break from home. Home ties were very strong and not easy to break. He decided to go off just a little way. So he went to Clinton, Massachusetts, a nearby town, where he got a job addressing mailing wrappers for newspapers in a printing house.
Moody!
Yes, sir?
Look at all these complaints. Some didn't get their papers, others got two. What are you doing?
Well, the house numbers with one half on it, I sent to the next address. Whoever heard of a house number one and a half? There ain't no such thing as half a house.
What? You're nothing more than an ignorant country boy. You're fired.
Back in 2022, I lost two very important people in my life. Big figures. It really wasn't until February...
Oh, this is hard work, George.
Oh, come on, Dwight. You're a big, strong guy. Mother needs the wood for winter, and you gotta help.
That's what you think, George. I'm gonna leave home and head for Boston.
Not that old stuff again. Just because you didn't make a go of it at the printing house doesn't mean you can't do it farming.
George, I tell you, my mind's made up. This here's not the life for me. But if I can't make it in the city, then I guess I ain't gonna make it anywhere.
You'll break Mother's heart. You know how she feels about Israel leaving home.
Yeah, George, I know, but I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna do it just the same. But I'll get a job at Uncle Sam's shoe store.
Who says he'll take you in?
Well, I do. It's final. I'm going to Boston on the next train.
Ready or not, the brash young Mr. Moody, age 17, had made his decision. He pumped up his courage and said goodbye to his mother, who was already mourning the sudden disappearance of one son, Israel. She didn't know where he was, or whether he was dead or alive.
Mother, I'm going now. I've got a train to catch.
Oh, Dwight, I'm going to miss you, son. Well, goodbye, my dear. Remember to do what you've been taught. I'll pray for you every day.
Oh, please don't cry. I have to try this on my own.
I know.
Goodbye.
On the way to the train station, he met his brother George, who wished him the best and slipped a $5 bill into his hand. Then he rushed to the waiting train and boarded.
Get on board, young man. All aboard! All aboard!
Young Mr. Moody left home, choked full with emotions. Sadness and excitement, love and adventure. All the mixed emotion involved with this major step in a young man's life. As he steps out on his own to seek his fortune or his misfortune. So we conclude chapter 2 of the story, Layman from God, a portrait of D.L. Moody. This is another in the series, Stories of Great Christians, produced by the Department of Broadcasting of the Moody Bible Institute in Chicago.
Chapter 2 of D.L. Moody and a series of 25, a young boy with lots of ambition, a little spunk, trying to find his way. Well, join us tomorrow, Lord willing, and we will hear what happens in Chapter 3. Till then, may the Lord bless you and keep you for this weekend edition. Till next time, God bless. Have a great day. Be in church. Help your pastor pray for him.